name is Bruce Barnes. I'm a member of the New Bedford Preservation Society, and today's tour is Rural Cemetery. Now, the Preservation Society actually has a nice history with the cemetery tours. Not so much the type of tour we're doing today, but we had lots of tours in the past where we had people who would portray various people and we'd talk about the stones and so forth. So we've been doing this type of tour for quite a while. Not me in particular, but the Society has been very interested in touring cemeteries in the past. And today we're going to be doing that. Before I get started, though, I want you to be a little bit aware of the little list that I gave out to most people here. We tried to print enough. We weren't sure how many people were going to come, and we were hoping we'd have enough. I think there's probably a little bit short. But anyway, if you don't have one, if you could share with somebody. But the symbols list here, as you're walking through, when I go to a particular spot and stop and talk about something, and then we walk to something else. If you see on any of the stones, as you're walking by, any of the symbols, just let, you know, note it, and I can point out, and you can look on this and on the sheet, see what it says, and maybe share that information when we make the next stop. Because there's a lot of the stones are like that. They're kind of cool. A brief history about the rural cemetery. It was established in 1837. Now, this was in the early years of a new version of cemeteries. They were called, and oddly enough, they were called the Rural Cemetery Movement, where they were building cemeteries in the cities mostly that had this park-like setting. Used in the past, before this time, most of the cemeteries were either in family plots, church plots, of course, was a big, big place for cemeteries behind and nearby churches, and sometimes large plots, public plots as well. But they were just long rows of cemeteries. Well, in the 1830s, somebody came up with the idea of designing cemeteries so they were like parks, where you could walk through and there'd be roadways and there'd be trees planted and there'd be a pleasant place to be. And the signature cemetery that started it all, or pretty close to started it all, was Mount Auburn Cemetery in Watertown, Mass. It's also part of the cemetery is in Cambridge, a spectacular place still, perhaps one of the most important cemeteries really in the country. It's a beautiful place. They've developed it into almost an arboretum. Some spectacular stones are there. Lots of famous people are buried there. It's just a beautiful place. The mount itself, there is an actual mount in the middle of the cemetery, which has graves along and pathways. And when you get to the top of the mount, it's a spectacular view of the Boston skyline and everything else around. It's just a beautiful place. If you get hooked on cemeteries, like I did, obviously, at one point, because I'm the one who put this list together, it's a place to go because it's really quite spectacular. You know, Watertown, that section of Cambridge is not the easiest place to get to from anywhere, it seems to me. But if you can find the place, it's really worth it. It's also, oddly enough, it's also a famous bird watching place, because it's a spot where migrating birds stop either going south for the winter or north for the summertime. So it's also a big place for people who enjoy bird watching. Anyway, there's lots of cemeteries in that style in New England. Most of the city's cemeteries that were established after the 1830s are like this park-like setting. Even in Fall River, there's another beautiful cemetery in Boston and Jamaica Plain called Forest Hills, a spectacular cemetery. With fabulous monuments and symbolism on their monuments. Perhaps the best cemetery I went to was at Forest Hills. It's not that difficult to get to. It's right on the Jamaica Way, if you're familiar with that part of going to Boston from off Route 1. And there's other cemeteries as well you might want to visit if you're interested in this subject. One of the nice old cemeteries that I don't want to forget to mention, where the cemetery stones are from the 1700s and some of the late 1600s, and it's nearby, is in Little Compton. The Little Compton Common Cemetery, if you've been to Little Compton, the big church that's in the middle of the common there. It has a great, great collection of early 18th century and late 17th century stones, mostly slate, local slate that they used at the time. Anyway, that's a little introduction to the cemeteries. We're going to go up this first roadway here, second one actually, and we're going to take a right, and talk about that big monument there that's dirt covered first. This particular site, or this form, is called a tumulus. It's an earthen covered vault. Very, very common. This style with the earth covered. You see it in almost every cemetery, even small cemeteries. The little cemetery in Westport, where I live now, has one of these. Not a big one, but it has a tumulus, as it's called, an earthen covered space. And the space inside was called a receiving vault. It was a place to store bodies in the wintertime when you couldn't dig graves. That's what it was used for. Every time you see one of these, it's called a receiving vault. And a receiving vault of this size probably held about 50 bodies. Now, later on, at the end of the tour, when we're coming back, the rural cemetery built another one. If you're familiar with rural cemeteries, the one with the rubble stone outside siding. So anyway, we'll see that when we're coming back. That was another receiving vault. The cemetery is getting so big and so forth that they had to put another one in. Now, there was the other great cemetery, a city-owned cemetery in New Bedford, is Oak Grove, which is down by the new high school. And that's a terrific cemetery as well. And they have a beautiful receiving vault that was built in the 1890s. So I did a little bit of work on that because I found some information on it. And so this is what they were used for. If they had a lot of bodies that they couldn't bury right away for whatever reason, they'd use a receiving vault. But it was primarily used in the wintertime because they couldn't dig grave sites in the wintertime because the ground was frozen. Basically, that's what it's all about. And this form, called the tumulus, was what was used. Now, the unique thing about New Bedford here at Rural Cemetery, considering this structure here is probably built not too long after the cemetery was established in 1837, is this great Gothic Revival style. This is the only Gothic Revival style tumulus I bet there ever was, because most of the tombs like this in the 1830s and 40s used Egyptian revival architecture for their tumulus. And that was almost universal. But for some reason, New Bedford decided to break tradition and built this really great, what's the stone?
The brownstone.
Brownstone. It's brownstone. Again, we're going to see a couple other brownstone monuments on today's tour, but it's not a common stone in cemeteries. You know, you'll see a handful of them in every big cemetery. There'll be a brownstone monument, but the whole thing here is brownstone. Now, most of the stones that we're going to see today are either granite or marble. This is the oldest section of the cemetery in this part here. These first, few rows from the brick building there out this way. This is the oldest part of the cemetery, 30s, 40s, 50s, and 60s. And most of the stones from that period are marble. They did use some granite, but you can see as we were walking by, almost 90% of the stones are marble. Originally, they would have been bright white marble. They have not lasted the test of time very well at all. If anybody saw the stone that was used for our advertising, we're going to go buy it in a little while, you'll see how much it's aged in the last 15 years. When I took that picture, it was in really almost perfect condition. And when I went to look at it again to find it, once again for the tour today, it has not aged well at all. We're going to see it in a few minutes, actually. But marble was used from the 1830s to really, it's still used somewhat even today. But it was almost completely used all the time from the 30s to the 70s and 80s, even 1870s and 1880s. And then they started to gradually go over to granite. And sometimes they would use brownstone or some other stone. But basically, those were the two major stones that were used during that time. And much of the stones we're going to see are going to be marble, especially the ones that are highly carved with the symbols that we're going to see. I wanted to talk briefly about the unusual influence of Egyptian the symbolism of ancient Egypt in cemeteries. And the main symbol, as you can see all around, is the obelisk. Victorian and even earlier, you know, this was a very, very Christian era in the United States. Most people were God-fearing people, went to church. Lifespans could be very short. That's most of the scholars think that that's why there's so much symbolism on some of the stones, is because, you know, life could end very quickly through disease, waterborne disease like diphtheria. Tuberculosis could strike anybody at any time, and it was, you know, life was very haphazard. The lifespan was very haphazard. And so they spent a lot of time thinking about death and worrying about death. And when people did die, they wanted to remember them. But the use of Egyptian symbolism, a pagan religion by any means, is kind of interesting. Not that the Egyptians weren't very interested in the afterlife. It was clear that they were. The pyramids are a gigantic tomb. Many of the great architectural details in ancient Egypt that have been discovered and were even discovered and known about by the time of the 1830s, even in the Renaissance, they had a pretty keen idea of how rabid the Egyptians were about the afterlife and preparing for the afterlife. And so it's not too unusual that they would use a lot of symbolism in cemetery monuments. Now, when I mentioned Mount Auburn Cemetery, the gates for Mount Auburn Cemetery are a very elaborate Egyptian design. It almost looks like you're going into the Temple of Luxor, actually. When you approach from the street, it has a fabulous granite facade that extends for quite a while. Some beautiful, beautiful mark etchings and hieroglyphic types of designs in the stone at the entrance to Mount Auburn Cemetery. And in other cemeteries as well that you might go to, you'll see a lot of Egyptian symbolism and architecture in the stones themselves. Kind of interesting, really. I mean, because they could have used, I guess, almost a lot of other types of symbolism and architectural details for cemetery monuments, but the obelisk is still used today. You'll see brand new gravestones with obelisk. Really, with an obelisk, you get a lot of bang for your buck. You know, it stands out, people notice it, you can't miss it when you're going through something. So there it is. You know, you can get a lot of recognition with one stone. It's not that difficult to there's some carving here right in the obelisk itself, but basically it's a big stone you could probably crank out quite easily. You got to remember that the original obelisks in ancient Egypt were one piece of stone, sometimes 60, 70 feet, one piece of stone. They weren't put to cobble together by bricks or anything. One giant piece of stone. Can you imagine shipping that in 3000 BC? I don't know how many tons that would be, but it's unbelievable, really. Anyway, that's a little bit of interesting history. No matter what cemetery you go to, you're going to see remnants symbols of Egyptian culture in the stones themselves. Sometimes, if it's just not obelisks, sometimes it's actually fancy stones as well. I'm assuming that they carved the leaf out of the same stone. It's really quite a job. Edward D. Mandel, for those of you who've been on my other tours, talked about the Mandel House quite a bit on a couple of tours. His gigantic mansion, perhaps one of the largest residential properties ever built in New Bedford, torn down around 1960. The site of his house is now the site of the Jewish convalescent home. If people remember my story about Ed Mandel and the Jewish and the site there, he owned a gigantic house there. He died in 1897. I think that's what that says. And this is a palm from frond here. Beautifully done, really. I think it can't be applied. It must have been carved right out of the big piece of stone when they did it. quite a piece of artwork, actually. John Avery Parker, very famous whaling merchant and a man about town during his day. He owned two of the most famous houses in New Bedford in his time, both of which unfortunately have been demolished. But the house that he owned on County Street out by Klasky Park was right on County Street, probably the most famous residential property that was ever built here. It's in all the history books about the city, the John Avery Parker House. It looked like it was a big stone Greek revival. It had two wings on either side of the house. Actually, one of the wings still stands on Pearl Street out there on in that part of the city. That's Parker's obelisk with the urn on top. This is a Civil War general, I believe. Is this Pierce? I think this is Edward Pierce, who was this is Parker here. And that one, I think, is Pierce. This is brownstone, but it has this Gothic, and it's clearly an obelisk form, but it has this Gothic decoration here and at the top. So they're mixing and matching styles, I guess, with this particular. And the brownstone is sort of held up. The carving of the names isn't so great, but nonetheless. And this stone here, again, giant marble monument, again, with the urn and a little bit of drape or a sash across the top there. Beautifully done. Look at the flowers along the edges and so forth. Quite spectacular. The huge monument behind you is the John Clifford Monument, John H. Clifford. He's a very famous lawyer in New Bedford, the only man from New Bedford to become governor of the Commonwealth. He was governor of Massachusetts from 1853 to 1854. He only served one term by choice. He was a long-term attorney general for the state of Massachusetts from the late 30s until around 1860. So he was a very influential man. His sons as well became very important lawyers in the city after he died, I think around 1876. But truly a monumental monument here. You got little columns holding up the bottom, and you got that fancy top and so forth. Didn't spare much expense on that particular monument when they put that one up. John H. Clifford. Not notable for the fancy stones or anything, but it's notable because it's this. This is the burial site for New Bedford's veterans of the Civil War. And it's a very cool place if you're interested in history and know a little bit about the regiments that served and so forth. A lot of the guys who are here were not killed during the war, unfortunately. Most of the, as we all know, the Civil War was an awful thing. Hundreds of thousands of men were killed and died as a result of the war. And those that were killed on the battlefield were usually buried on site in mass graves. People who had a lot of money would have been able to have their bodies shipped back to New Bedford. But for the most part, men who died in service were not buried here at the site. But New Bedford did have over 3,000 people who served in the war. And so when they passed away, they were buried here. And it's nice that they have the regiment that they served under and their names and so forth. It's just a nice site. When we did our walk cemetery tours way back, we used to have betrayers who would betray various soldiers who managed to survive the war and talk about their experiences during the war. So it's historic, and it's just kind of a nice hallowed ground here for the men who did serve and managed to come back, because it was not an easy war to come back from. There was lots of death. Now, before we leave this particular site, the rubble stone building, I believe, is also a receiving vault, because it doesn't have any windows. If it had windows, it could be a chapel, but it doesn't have any windows. So I'm pretty sure that's a receiving vault as well. That particular receiving vault was similar to the one that I was referring to that's at Oak Grove. And the one at Oak Grove was built for 72 bodies. That one probably might be a little bit bigger, actually, so it might be close to 80 to 100. That, again, would be a place where they would store bodies. Even in the 1890s and early 1900s, they still weren't using backhoes to dig graves. It was all done by hand. And during the wintertime, ground was too hard to dig up. And that's why they used receiving vaults. This is just an example of a family plot. Unfortunately, somebody's just toppled this one over. That was pretty common. And they didn't even put a foundation. They just put posts in the ground. But it's a nice fence, nice post on the fence. It's a really kind of a cool stone in this particular. I think this is the Wardell plot. And you see the nice lily of the valley that's carved in the top of the stone here. Pretty nice. Very nice, actually. But this is kind of what a lot of the families had these plots, and they all had these metal fences that we pointed out before. An urn with a dove on top. The dove looks like he's lost his head, but he still looks kind of interesting. Nice urn. Obelisk. And also, I didn't even notice the anchor. Probably a sailor. Certainly a sailor. And the wreath as well. The beauty. Seabury. This is the Jones plot. Now, yeah. See how this is a brand new stone, actually. 2016. They made it look like the old ones, but it's very, very smooth. It's in perfect shape still. This is the Jones family plot, the RJD Jones. Amelia Jones is, she's right there. And her father, Edward Coffin Jones, is someplace nearby as well, right in the back there. Kind of considering the importance the family had in the city for a long, long time, kind of modest stones. Thank you for coming.